Cheech and Chong did a song called Basketball Jones by Tyrone Shoelaces. On that record, it was got to number 15 on the Billboard charts. On that record was George Harrison, Carole King, Billy Preston, Darlene Love, Michelle Phillips, Klaus Voormann, and others. So it was an all-star lineup. The drummer on that record was Jim Karstein. Jim is also, I think, probably would tell you, give him a chance to do that in a minute, that perhaps the biggest deal in his career was he was J.J. Cale's drummer for many, many years, a tour studio everywhere. So let's welcome Jim Karstein to visit with us for a few minutes. First of all, let's take care of some old business. We were talking about the Wrecking Crew, and you had an experience with the Wrecking Crew. We saw Hal Blaine on the documentary, The Drummer. You had a lot of experiences with the Wrecking Crew. Leon, when he moved out there,
so we're talking about Leon Russell.
Leon Russell, and when he got out to California, he started meeting people, and his talent took him right to the top of the heap out there. And for a period of time, there wasn't hardly anybody else from Tulsa living out there except Leon and I. And I was living down here in a boarding house, and he had an apartment up the road a little ways. And he'd come by and get me, and I'd go with him to these sessions. Now, mind you, he would do three sessions almost, maybe not every day, but a lot of days. He'd maybe work one from 11 to 2, and then one from 3 to 6, and then one from 8 to, you know. And if he had things he wanted me to do, I didn't do it every time. Cut all his hits, the Wall of Sound studio. And it wasn't anything elaborate or huge. It was just another studio. And the parking, and you parked in back, kind of, it was pretty cramped. You went into an alley, and there was an area back there for maybe 15 cars, and I pulled up. It was pretty full, so I just kind of pulled in there. And just as I pulled in, the door opened and everybody was filtering out. And you walked through that door and you just went, well, from here to there. And there was another door, and that was where the booth was. And then you went through another door, and that's where the room to the studio was. And since the session was over, they had all those doors propped open. And everybody was just filtering out. And I was, hello, how you doing? I knew a handful of them. And so Leon starts filtering out. And right here, coming out of the booth, they're doing a playback. And they got it cranked up pretty good. And I'm sitting here, and it kind of caught my ear. Leon's sitting here probably talking to Al or somebody. And I said, say, Leon, I said, who's that singing? He said, that's Sonny Bono's wife. She sings pretty good, doesn't she? And I got to know Hal the best of all the Wrecking Crew. For one reason, he was one of the most affable of the whole crew. Hal's a great guy. And John mentioned that I had worked with Gary Lewis and the Playboys. Well, Leon had teamed up with, as the name probably nobody in here would be familiar with, named Snuff Garrett. But he, if anybody helped coin the term record producer, it was him. He helped give Phil Spector his start. And one day it was my job to hang his gold records in the office, and it took me all afternoon. It just went down one long hallway and up the other. Extremely successful. And he snatched Leon up because he recognized his talent as an arranger. And so when Gary Lewis started having those hits, Leon arranged all those. And Carl Radle from Tulsa played bass. And
Triple Horn was on that band?
Triple Horn played guitar, although if you hear some of that real adroit guitar acoustic little hot licks on there, what you'd call them, that's Tommy Tedesco,
who you saw in the documentary.
Yeah, yeah. And whose son, by the way, made that documentary. And but anyway, whoever all the players were, we'd been out on the road, and They said, okay, we're going to record Tuesday, be down to RCA, you know, 10 o'clock in the morning or noon or whenever it was, 1 o'clock in the afternoon. We're going to record and come on down. Now, Hal's going to play, but you come on down. And I went down, and you, when you walked in, the big room at RCA where there's Rolling Stones kept Satisfaction, and huge room, and with that engineer, too, by the way, Dave Passenger. And you walked in, they had a little table, and there was the, in those days, the W4s, which today a 1099. And they said, here, Jimmy, fill that out. And I filled it out. Later, got to go down to the union and collect my check, too. But I walked in, and Hal was sitting in there, had his drums. He was actually the drummer that was hired to play on the date. And I went, wow, I like this. I get to pull up a chair and get a lesson on how to cut a record from Hal Blaine and get paid for it, too.
There you go.
So, I, you know, I mean, that didn't bother me at all, but I got down there and Hal was actually the drummer of record.
And that happened a lot with a lot of those West Coast groups, right? When you went in the studio, when people went in the studio.
Yeah, and you know,
Blaine.
If you read that book.
Jim was just telling me about a new book.
Yeah.
On the Wrecking Crew.
It's called The Wrecking Crew. It's just the same title as the movie, only done by somebody completely different, and it's a completely different take on the whole thing. What group was it? I think it was, they zero in on that. The flip side of that Gary Puckett and the Union Gap. And they started having hits, and so the producers and the record companies and all the guys with the cigars said, baby, let's get rid of that band, you know, let's get the real guys in here. And his band, really, somebody in that band just had a fit, you know. So it could, you know, but it didn't bother me at all. I was happy. Of course, Hal was a friend, and like I say, I got paid to get a lesson.
Just to watch.
Just to watch. I just pulled up a chair just like this and just watched them work.
Well, now, you were playing. You see, the thing about the Tulsa bands were that you guys played a lot of illegal clubs because, really, liquor by the drink was not legal then.
Yes, here.
In Oklahoma.
Yeah.
And so you started playing very young. You were still in high school when you were playing.
Oh, yeah.
Those joints, right?
Yeah.
And there was a bunch of them. And, of course, as Leon Russell has said, because it was illegal to start out with, well, then anything goes, you know, and so they just have you play for eight hours maybe sometimes. Mm-hmm. So when did you first go out to California, and how was it different? How was the scene different in California than in Tulsa?
Excuse me. Well, the music was more advanced. The groups that played, that you get... it was really structured as far as, and a lot of even the old night, funky old nightclubs in those days were unionized.
Mm-hmm.
Excuse me, I had to get an assumed name and a phony Social Security card so I could join that union out there, because you couldn't just go in and join the union. If you transferred into that union, there was a grace period. You had to wait like 3 months or 6 months, or I don't know exactly what the length of time was. So to bypass that, you just got a phony Social Security card and joined that union. But the main thing was the age, because California was and still is much stricter on, you got to get in here, if you're coming in, you got to be 21. So I had... I knew I had to have some phony IDs, and...
This is early 60s, 61 or so?
Yeah, this is 61. I went out to California 2 weeks after I graduated. And I worked my senior year with David Gates. David Gates and the Accents locally, and then he went on to have a group called Bread, if anybody's familiar with that. And so he had gone to OU, and he knew somebody down there that made counterfeit draft cards, and you could buy them. I don't know, in those days it was a pretty premium price. It was like $50
yeah.
or something. I don't know what it was, which is not a giveaway these days, but I mean it wasn't $5 or $10. I don't know. And all you had to do is put it on top runner, top it out. The only hook was down. The lady from the draft board that signed them, whose name was Laura T. Brown, and she had this very flowing script handwriting. And Leon's always had very beautiful handwriting. And I said, Leon, and I showed him a real draft card with her signature, and he sat down and copied that. He signed Laura T. Brown and forged the signature. And then when I got out there, I ran back over to Nevada, and you could just walk up and say, I swear, you know, I didn't say I was exactly 21. I boosted it to 22 and a half or something like that.
You were what, 18?
18, yeah. And I swear, that's all you had to do was just, I swear. And I said, yeah. And so I had a photo ID with my picture on, photo ID, driver's license, and a draft card. And it was bulletproof.
So you thought.
Yeah. And, well, it was, and it worked like a charm till 8 months before I turned 21. I worked in this little funky joint, and we were just finishing up. You always played 9 to 2 out there, not 9:15 or 9:30 or a quarter of 10 or whatever you get away with now, till a lot of bands quit at 1 or 1:30. It was 9 o'clock till a quarter of 2, and I mean, there was a guy standing around there, and you played those 5 sets every night. And we were just about to finish. That was a big difference than it was here.
Sure, yeah.
And I noticed some commotion. It was dark in there. Some commotion against the back wall. I didn't think anything of it. I broke down my drums, and I just gotten lucky and had pole position outside the front door. So I hauled my drums out and was putting them, I always drove a station wagon, and put my drums in the back and had gone around, got behind the wheel, and was just about to turn into a... And I looked over, and there was just a badge right there. And so he said, open this door. And I opened the door, and he got in there, and he said, let me see your IDs. And I showed him those phony IDs, and he just sat there, and he had a flashlight. And the longer he looked at him, the madder he got. And because he knew I wasn't 21. And or by that time, whatever, I was probably 22 and a half or 23.
Right.
And he wasn't buying it. He knew it. What I did was always kept my real driver's license and ID in the glove box in case I ever got a traffic stop. I could give them my real and not jeopardize my work IDs. And he just sat there, and he was just about to give up, I think. And the longer he sat there, the madder he got, because he just couldn't bust those IDs. And he just, for some reason, he just flipped open the glove box, and there was a little zip bag, had some road maps and everything, and there they were. And he looked at me, and he said, he was really, he was mad. There was nothing funny about it at that time. So here we go. And I called Leon about 3 o'clock in the morning. I said, Leon, would you come bail me out of jail? And he did. Leon was a great guy. And so that was one of them. But really, musically, they were just more advanced out there. There was just Los Angeles. I mean, there's just such a vast musical community out there. And they had, you know, they picked up on a lot of stuff out there that we didn't.
I used to think that there was took about 2 years for that kind of stuff to get to the middle of the country What was the scene like in the mid '60s? If you were a kid and you were out on the street in L.A., what was that live music scene like?
Oh, it was great. Of course, the center of the universe was the Sunset Strip,
right?
It was just. It was just, you know, of course, we were young, and it was, you know, it was just like fireworks going off. It was
something happened. California thing.
Yeah. There was a series that was on, I think it was Oliver Stone, did a thing on the 60s, and the last one was called Sex, Drugs, and Rock and Roll, and there's a good section in that that really shows what it was like.
Will you tell the story about the little club?
Oh, yeah, Pandora's Box.
Yeah.
If you ever get to Los Angeles and you take a trip down the Sunset Strip,
right,
which was an album that Gail recorded,
right,
at Leon's studio.
By the Leather Coated Mines.
Leather
Coated Mines was the name of that band. Yeah.
And where Crescent Heights hits Sunset, there's a esplanade. It's just a triangle shape. It's and then it kind of dog legs and it turns into Laurel Canyon. Well, when we got there in the 60s, there was a coffee house that was sitting on there. If you go by it today, you wouldn't think, well, how could you get a whole nightclub on that little piece of land? But they did. It was called Pandora's Box. And it was just a coffee house. They had fruit juices and coffees and espresso and everything. They didn't serve any alcohol at all. And Leon was dating Jackie DeShannon, who, if anybody in here, what the world needs now is love.
Put a little love in your heart.
Yeah, put a little love. Yeah, she had many hits. And Jackie was best friends with a gal named Sharon Sheely, who was dating Jimmy O'Neill, who was the number one disc jockey on the number one station in L.A. And so, you know, 6 degrees of separation. There was only four there. And right over here is Carl Radel and me.
Mm-hmm.
And they decided, Jimmy O'Neill and KRLA decided, what we need to do is fake Jackie at Pandora's Box. And so, done. The only thing nobody remembered was she had just, as we were going to kick this big thing off, she went in for a nose job. And so she couldn't do it. So they had us, we kicked it off, and every night for like 2 or 3 weeks, well, I don't know, it went on for quite a while, they'd run a different star in every night, Jan and Dean and Bobby Rydell and I don't know who all. And it had a basement. If you ever get out there and see it and think, and there was even a basement there. A guy named Preston Epps had an instrumental hit called Bongo Rock back in the 50s or 60s, somewhere. A minor hit, it wasn't a big hit. And he was when we'd take a break, he'd go up and play for 15 or 20 minutes, and then he'd go back downstairs. And then on, I don't know, on weekends too, or for sure Sunday nights was the off-night band. And some nights there would be Leon, the trio, and this other band.
Now the trio was you and Leon and Carl?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, Leon and Carl and I. And so it went on and on. I don't know how long. You know, it seemed like it went on for a long time. Maybe it went on for 3 or 4 months or however long all that action went on. And so the curtain fell and time passed, and I wound up that Christmas, I guess, I came home and wound up staying here for a little while for some reason or another. I don't know what it was. I'd been home for a couple of months, I guess. I'd had Christmas and then stayed. And one day I thought, well, I'll call Leon and see what he's up to. And so I called up Leon and we're chewing the fat. And I said, oh, say, Leon, I said, by the way, I said, you know that band that played opposite us down at Pandora's Box? And they just sounded like the original garage band, just coming out of amateur status, maybe still kind of in it, just the rawest, simplest, just... We really didn't think they were very good at all, to tell you the truth. And I said, Leon, I said, you know that band that used to play down there opposite us at Pandora's Box? I said, they've had 2 or 3 hit records, and they were terrible. He said, yeah, I know. He said, I know. He said, but that piano player in the band was a genius. He said, is a genius. Well, it was the Beach Boys.
And the piano player was Brian Wilson.
Yeah. And they were just the most basic kind of a thing you could ever imagine, just garage band to the, you know, to, you can put an exponent behind that.
That was the Panda, and then there was a Whiskey Go-Go was down there at that same time when you got, was that the big club?
That turned in about, I don't know if Johnny Rivers had put it on the map yet or not, but for one period of time there, in kind of the early mid-60s, the whole focus, it seemed like, the whole music industry there for a little bit was Whiskey A Go-Go. That name caught on, and Johnny Rivers was the king of the heat. But he was actually the only king down there. He was it.
Yeah.
And then Johnny Cale is known as J.J. Cale. Now, this is from Cale. Of course, he'll tell you the Arkansas River's got Pepsi Cola in it. He played the off nights down there with Johnny Rivers. And the guy that ran it, Elmer Valentine, if you want to believe that name. Cale took a break and he said, come here a minute. He said, I want you to come outside with me. And he looked up there and he said, look up there. He said, I've got Johnny Rivers. And he said, I've got Johnny Cale. He said, I got too many Johnnies on my marquee. He said, from now on, I'm going to put J.J. up there.
And that's how it became J.J. Cale. That's right. And the people like Jim, of course, who knew Cale, always call him. You can always tell somebody, if you're talking to somebody, and you're talking about Cale, who, of course, passed away last year, if they're calling him John, they knew
him. Yeah.
You guys knew whoever called him John. Now, Jim, I should have mentioned, and I didn't, is on the brand new Eric Clapton album. That came out that was a tribute to J.J. Cale, and that album's doing real well. I was looking, it's selling a lot.
Jackie, when it first came out, she said she looked it up on the internet or something, and it was number 2 or something. I don't know if it's still up there or not, because it's been out since the end of July.
But you played on several cuts? How many cuts you play on?
Well, no. Now, we only... The guys from Tulsa...
And there's a bunch of drummers.
Yeah, there was a truckload of drummers out there. Well, the situation was Eric was going to cut a new Eric Clapton album, and he'd already hired Jim Keltner and Nathan East, bass and drums and bass, in that order. And Cale died. And he said, I'm going to change my focus. He said, He said, it just came to him. He said, I think I'll do a tribute to Cale, because he really admired Cale. And he said, I'm going to jump tracks and go over here and do this album dedicated to Cale. And it's interesting. Have you seen that interview on YouTube, I think it is. Thing on VH1, but that was more of a promo for the album. But he does an in-depth interview on YouTube, I think it is. Well, when we were doing it, I was kind of... The first night we got together was kind of a meet and greet, and he'd already started working on tracks for this thing. And so we get to the studio, and everybody high, and everybody's talking and milling around, and then they finally, somebody in the booth over there, they decided they'd start the playbacks, and I'm out here probably talking to Keltner or somebody, and I said, oh, they're playing, let's go in and listen. So I go in, and the second I stick my head in, I go, well, now, no, because whatever song it was one of Cale's regulars, After Midnight or Call Me the Breeze, or one of the standards. And I went, well, that's close, but that's not the real track. And the voice was even closer, I thought, and I just went, whew. And then, come to find out, that's what Cale had done. He had that's what Clapton had intentionally tried to copy the J.J. Cale sound. And I'm kind of thinking, as we did it, we actually only recorded it. That was on Friday, and then we went back in on Saturday and did some stuff. They gave us Sunday off, and we recorded Monday and Tuesday and did two tracks each. Mm-hmm. each day. And the only one that's on that album that I can really say for sure that I know that we cut was, it's called Train to Nowhere or something like that. And I asked Christine about that here not long ago.
That's J.J. Cale's widow.
Yeah, and I said, what were the other songs that we did? And she said, and I was really surprised because she's, you know, if it was had to do with John, she knows just photographic. But she didn't. She said, I'll have to check my notes. She said, I said, well, when the record came out, I said, that's the only one that I know for sure that we did.
Tulsa. I had lived, had been invited to live, move and live in Leon Russell's house out in L.A. He mistakenly thought I was... It had gotten around because I like to do recordings and play with tape recorders and such, that maybe I was some kind of electronic genius,
sure,
which I wasn't. But anyway, he invited me to come live at his house where he had a full-blown recording studio in the lower portion of this two-story house.
And this was out in the hills, Hollywood Hills, right?
Yeah. You could stand on the front porch and look across the freeway to Universal City, which I thought, for a Tulsa kid, I think I was, maybe you just turned 18, and that was a big deal for me.
Yeah.
I lived in Karstein's closet. There was a walk-in closet that Karstein had put some kind of Dutch doors on it, and it was actually really quite comfortable. Put a mattress on the floor, TV down at the end of the closet. Anyway, so, the thing was that we were all very quite influenced with Leon's work, and he really had a, he had a way of, I don't know how he got into the black gospel thing, but it was so linked to the kind of music we were all listening to that was coming out of Memphis that, I don't know, just was great, incredible. Well, anyway, so then a few years later, I'd moved back to Tulsa, and Skip had come back off the road. He'd played with some various people, and we formed this Teegarden Van Winkle. So then when some guy came through, happened to come through Tulsa on his way to California for the Bobby Kennedy, the primary election. And so this guy was out of college and fresh and full of political, wanted to help out, you know, on the Kennedy deal. He happened to come through Tulsa. We had a rainstorm, it was gully washer, and cars were sliding all around, so he decided to stay for the evening and came into a club that we were playing, and he just went nuts. Everybody thought he was a knocker, because he kept sitting around at everybody's table and driving everybody crazy, and us too. They just go nuts over you guys. So I gave him a number, because you don't want to turn down anything, you know, until you vet it out. Anyway, so we know the story. He went on to L.A. Bobby Kennedy was assassinated, and a week later, this guy called me. He was back in Detroit and pleading with us to come make the journey up there and get our fame, discover our fame and fortune, whatever. So anyway, maybe a year or two later, we did make some inroads. We recorded an album, actually two albums. But our first album got on Atlantic Records, which was a big deal. And we sold 10,000 albums. Not a lot, but that's made enough impact that they let us do another album, which didn't sell so much. And so they dropped us, and so we were in dire straits, no pun intended, or whatever, the band. So, in the meantime, Leon had put the thing together for Joe Cocker and the Mad Dogs and Englishmen. I don't know if you guys have
We didn't really go over.
Haven't gotten into that yet.
A huge touring show with Joe Cocker, the singer.
Yeah, it was a big deal. I mean, had tons of Okies on it.
Yeah.
And he was kind of directing it all and playing piano and kind of, you know, he'd direct all. I don't know, they had probably 6 or 7 background singers.
Yes.
And several drummers and several guitar players and such, and it was a big deal, and it was all, you know, Joe Cocker was so soulful, and Leon really incorporated that gospel thing into the Joe Cocker deal, and so we were real inspired. Their first gig was in Detroit, and Leon called me to announce they were coming to Detroit. They did 2 nights, sold out at Easttown Theater, and so we went over to the hotel where they were staying, just got on the bus like we were going to the gig, you know. And we were so inspired with the show that Skip started writing this song, God Love and Rock and Roll, and he played it on the piano for me. He said, does this sound too much like we're stealing from... There was a song that Curtis Mayfield had written called Amen, and it had won an Academy Award for it. And anyway, he played this Amen, Amen. I said, Amen for God, Love, and Rock and Roll. I said, yeah, it sounds just like it, but I'm acting like I thought I was an attorney or something. And I said, no, that'll be okay, because we're changing it, you know, at the end of the phrase, melodically and lyrically. So we recorded the organ and bass, I mean organ and drums, in a little cottage that our manager had on a lake that we were living, little hippie commune there. And we recorded one of our recording setup I had devised, and we recorded the basic track of just the music, and then we took it into Detroit, added, it was weird, we put it on a cassette, the music part, and gave it to these horn players and put them in a room and said, here, work out a horn arrangement best you can. And then we had some singers, six girls. And we rehearsed them on their parts and recorded them, and then we brought the horn players in, had them do their deal. And our manager took it around to sent it out to a bunch of record companies, and they, sounds great, it's not what we're looking for. And but there was a local distributor out of Detroit who had Department, Funkadelic, and Detroit Emeralds, and they were they were all black artists. We were one of the white artists, and they signed us on immediately when they heard the record. We didn't have an album, we just had a single, but that song was inspired by Leon Russell.
And it was inspired by Curtis Mayfield, apparently.
And we did get a lawsuit.
Yeah.
When it reached top 20, they slapped a lawsuit on us. And luckily, we had a pretty good attorney, and they dismissed it because it did change. Talk about luck.
Before you go, Dave, I would like for you to tell the story of the night that you had to go into the trucker restaurant, and what that led to. I think people will be interested in that. I think the guy's a classic.
Well, Seeger wrote that was kind of an anthem for him. But we had left Detroit with Bob and Mike Bruce and two roadies, and we had this truck. Skip and I purchased this truck that had bunks over the top of the cab of the truck. It's like a big U-Haul truck. It had a side door, and we put a wall there, and all the equipment was loaded from the back, and we got in. We could sleep four people in the box area or had somebody. But anyway, Mike Bruce was driving, and we were in the middle of a snow blizzard. We were going to North Dakota or South Dakota.
One of the Dakotas.
Mitchell, South Dakota is where we were headed for. And it was snowing like crazy, and it was about 3:34 in the morning. And I'm laying down on the floor of that box. We took out the back window and had a crawl through. If you had to crawl through, you could. And anyway, I kind of raised up because I heard Mike sound like he was pulling off the freeway. And I raised up and said, "Well, what's going on?" He said, "Well, I'm going to stop. I've had enough. Somebody else is going to have to drive." And we're pulling into a truck stop. And he says, "What's those guys waving at me?" And there were guys standing at the gas pump doing this. Bam! And he'd pull into the wrong one, and we hit the canopy with the box of the truck. And Seeger and Skip were up at that top bunk, and it was, we'd insulated it and put walls of plywood, and that plywood splintered and just went nuts, and they were screaming. They thought a bomb had gone off. They were okay. But, so, it was like, oh my God. So, we're all kind of getting out and went surveying the damage, and, so the roadies and I, we decided we'd just get the duct tape out and start duct taping that front up, the dented place up, so it won't snow in. And so told those guys to go on in the restaurant. It was all night cafe, and we all had long hair. But Bob and Skip and Mike all wore hats, and they'd take their hair and stick it up inside their caps. I didn't like wearing a hat or cap. It drove me nuts. So, okay, time to go in, get our coffee, and we went in. And I had to walk through a gauntlet of truckers all sitting there. And as I was walking down through there, they were all, "Hey, is that a woman or a man?" And Seeger and him were cracking up, Anyway, so we went on to the gig, played the gig that next night, and after the gig, we're sitting in the truck while the roadies were bringing the equipment out and loading. And Bob said, "Hey, I got this song." He had his guitar, acoustic guitar, out, and he said, "I wrote this song. I want you to hear it." And it was "Turn the Page." After he got done with it, well, yeah, that's pretty cool. Skip, my partner, said, "I don't know, Bob, it's got too many words in it."
And then, of course, if you know "Turn the Page," which was later on covered by Metallica, is what Bob Seger, it was an anthem for Bob Seger. Metallica almost had it for an anthem as well, pretty much. And it has the line about, "You never know, you're always outnumbered. Is that a woman or a man?" has a line in it. That is the inspiration for that line, the same old cliches. Is that a woman or a man? That was Dave that inspired.
It's too bad I didn't get writers on it.
No kidding.
Because it generated a ton of money. Oh, there was another one I didn't get credit on, but it was a line that actually came from Mike Bruce. You have a real long day, and you've been on the road or whatever, and he got into talking about the horizontal bob, which meant you're just going to lay down. But it had some other connotation
right,
to it.
Right.
But we'd get into a city, and, you know, maybe we had to take an early flight. This is later when I was with the Silver Bullet Band. And we'd get into a city, check in a hotel, and it'd still be kind of early, late morning. And all the girls, the background singers, and the road manager, they'd all be, "Well, what are we going to do? Let's go to a mall." Or they'd ask me, and I'd say, "What are you going to do?" I said, "Horizontal box." And
so it became
finally Seeger wrote a song called "The Horizontal Box."
There you go. Now, you won a Grammy for Against the Wind, Against the Wind album, is that correct?
Yeah. Yes.
And we're with Seeger for how long?
Well, not really all that long, but it seemed like so much happened in a short period of time with the Silver Bullet Band. It was 77 to 81. I think the last tour I did with him was in 81. And then, of course, previous to that, we had done, which is one of my favorite albums.
Yeah, it's a great record.
But anyway, we had some differences. It was funny because Bob went to Skip Van Winkle to first get organized that we're all going to play together deal, which was kind of a surprise to me, but I embraced it because Bob and I got along real well and musically thought a lot alike. I talked him into working at, if I were a carpenter.
Yes, that's right.
And we were doing the Bo Diddley thing, and Bob ended up singing it on the album. But anyway, Skip and Bob kind of got in.
Creative differences.
Differences.
Yeah, musical differences. Yeah.
And anyway.
Yeah. Does anybody, it's about time for us to break, but I wanted to have a couple minutes here. Does anybody have any questions or comments for Dave Teegarden?
So, he started out with a different band at first, and then he found you guys, and you guys changed it up and added a new guitar player and stuff. And
yeah. He had a band called The System.
Oh, yeah.
Bob Seger and The System. And I think they'd done two or three albums. But at some point, he when we became friends and before we joined together, I encouraged him to, and I could never admit it to the Silver Bullet guys because they hated it, but I encouraged him to go to Muscle Shoals.
Alabama, right.
Alabama, where that was a real happening scene down there. I had seen some kind of little brief CBS News profile of Aretha Franklin going to Muscle Shoals. Well, it turns out they only did about one night's worth down there, and they all got in fights or some, but not all of them. But,
right.
The studio owner got in a fight with Aretha's boyfriend, I think, and they took them all to New York to record most of it. But anyway, I was very impressed with the Muscle Shoals scene because so many people were recording there, and Bob went there. And from then on, half of all his albums were recorded at Muscle Shoals, which made the Silver Bullet Band not happy because that knocked them out of half the royalties.
Oh, man.
It was interesting. We played in Memphis, did two nights in Memphis with the Silver Bullet Band, and the Muscle Shoals people rented a bus and drove up to Memphis with the families and all that. And I was so excited to get to meet them, finally, which I did. They rented a steak, and I only took a steak. And we had a big party. Guys, all of them said, no, we're not going. And so it was me and Bob and Alto, the horn player, were the only ones from the Silver Bullet Band that went.
And the rest of them were the Muscle Shoals guys.
The rest of the Muscle Shoals guys and their families, and which were just beautiful people, wonderful to visit with. And it was a weird deal. They had at the end of the dinner, we were getting ready to break up, and somebody talked a waiter into taking a group picture. And not too long ago, the wife and I went to Circle Cinema, to see the documentary about Muscle Shoals. If you ever get a chance to see it, it's wonderful. But anyway, we're sitting there watching it, and they said, and Bob Seger recorded, you know, they were talking about all the Rolling Stones and Bob Seger, yeah. And then there was that picture from the restaurant, and there I'm right there, me and Bob. I thought, I'm in this movie.
Anybody else? Yes, ma'am.
Did you see Bob Seger when he came to town a few years back?
Yeah.
You did?
It was a fluke, and it was weird because one of the background singers, Sean Murphy, who still goes out with him, in fact, she was lead singer for Little Feet for a number of years. And she'd always call me when she was coming through town and we'd go have lunch or something. And she called well, maybe a month prior to them coming in, said, well, you got to come see the show. Everybody wants to see you. Talking about some people in the band. Sean, I don't really want to go, you know, because it knocked me out of millions of dollars by not being with him. And I said, I just feel fine, but we'll go to lunch or something. And anyway, but I said, you'll like the venue you're playing because it's brand new. At least the restrooms will be clean. and so, I don't know, about a week before she called me, said, you're coming, aren't you? And I'm still squeamish about it. Okay, I'll come down to the hotel. They stayed at the Mayo. And, but I never heard anything when they got into town, so then she called me and said, we're getting ready to go down to sound check. Come meet us at the hotel. So I did. And we followed them down to be okay, and they let us in the back. Back there and went in and shocked Seeger. I don't know why he didn't think he'd see me in Tulsa, but and he, oh, wow. And they did their sound check, and we got to sit out in the audience, which kind of like a personal show.
Yeah, yeah.
And then he came down and visited with us for, I don't know, a while, 45 minutes or so.
Yeah. So did you get over that then, losing all those millions of dollars?
No.
Just 45 minutes of visiting doesn't do that, does
no, it? No, it doesn't take care of it. But it was nice. Yeah. It was fun to see. And it was ironic. And I don't mean to hold you guys up, but what was weird was the way I got replaced was we hired a piano player that played on our last tour that played, I can't think of the name of the band. Big band. I mean, well-known band. We Are American.
Grand Funk.
Grand Funk Railroad. Mm-hmm. And this guy, the minute we hired him, he was like this with Bob. He just shadowed him. And poor Bob doesn't have a lot of friends. Well, he's got a lot of friends. But he just hung tight with Bob and started kind of putting the word in. His best friend was the drummer for Grand Funk, Don Brewer. He's a great drummer. I love the guy. We played a lot of shows with him. I mean, Skip and I, Van Winkle, and I have played a lot of shows in Detroit before they were Grand Funk, some of those guys. Anyway, but this guy kept, Teegarden's really dropping the sticks and stuff or something, you know, always putting weird stuff out. And finally, that guy got the gig and I was out. But when I was down there for a sound check, the road manager came by and we were talking. I hadn't seen him in a long time. He's a great guy, Bill Blackwell. And Craig Frost, the piano player, came walking down the hall and the road manager said, oh, there's the guy that broke up the Silver Bullet. But visiting with Bob, he came up and sat down in the seats with us, and we were talking, and Don Brewer, the drummer, came up. And because I gave him a big hug, he's a great guy. But it was interesting to see the security that Bob had with this Don Brewer. You know, I felt he relied on this guy, he really liked him a lot. So,
well, there you go.
That helped.
Yeah, that did. Anybody else? Yes, ma'am.
This is kind of like a random personal question, but do you have like a nephew or like young man in your family named Matthew who also does music?
How do you know Matthew?
No,
I'm yes, my youngest son.
Okay.
Did you go to TCS?
No, I work at it, so he played with his band at my work.
He's the apple of my eye.
Should say also that Dave Jr., Dave Teegarden Jr., is also plays a lot of music in this town as well. So
out of town.
Yeah,
I wrote a lot with Dustin Pitchley.
That's right, playing a lot with Dustin.
I got two drummers. The oldest son's a drummer, and the youngest one's a drummer. I couldn't get a brain surgeon out of it.
Well, folks, let's give Dave a hand, will you?
final break of the, let's take our final break of the afternoon. Let's get back here about 5:20. Okay.